Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This show was recorded live on USC's campus.
Welcome to our special summer edition of Dornsife Dialogues about the upcoming Olympics. These games are a rare chance, not only to see the best athletes in the world compete, but an opportunity to bring our global society together in a positive cultural exchange. You may not know, but USC is the only university in the world to have a gold medal winning athlete in every summer Olympiad since 1912. And this year, we'll be cheering on a number of our students, including one of our guests today. Tina Graudina is a political science major at USC Dornsife and a star player on USC's beach volleyball team, the 2021 national champions. I look forward to hearing what it has been like to train over this past extraordinary year. The second part of our conversation will explore how the Olympics have evolved since the first games were held in 776 BC. Most of the sports have changed significantly from the ancient games, but there remains an innate desire to watch our fellow humans push the limits of the body. Whether that's diving for a volleyball, running at blazing speed, or heaving sharp and heavy objects, just because. To better understand what has changed and what has stayed the same over 3,000 years, we'll be joined by two USC Dornsife experts in ancient Greece, Vincent Farenga, a professor of classics and comparative literature, and Lucas Herchenroeder, an associate professor teaching of classics. And in a Dornsife Dialogues first, our conversation today will be moderated by one of our tremendously talented undergraduate students. Sean Silvia is a senior majoring in archaeology and history. He is the host of Archaeologists Anonymous, a popular YouTube show that aims to educate and inspire empathy through engaging videos about humanity's past. He's also the host of a brand new video series showcasing all things Dornsife called A Door to Dornsife. Sean, it's a pleasure to have you and all of your guests with us here today. I will turn the program over to you.
All right, without any further ado, let's get started with the Dornsife Dialogue. So, Tina, congrats not only on being a member of this year's national champion beach volleyball team, but on competing in next month's Olympics. So, where are you training now?
Yes, hello, thank you very much. Currently, I am in Latvia, in my home. This is my room right here, and this is where we're preparing for Tokyo and what's to come in this summer.
So you're competing in the Olympics for Latvia, where you were born. Were you also raised in Latvia?
Yes, I am born and raised in Latvia. And however, I have been going to the United States for most of my childhood. So, and I also have a dual citizenship. So I, even though I do have the both passports, I feel very much Latvian still.
So what brought you to USC?
Yes, so this is a very loaded question, I would say, because my road to USC has been through athletics, through beach volleyball, and I had to make the decision what I wanted to do in my life, what kind of priorities I want to place for in my future in terms of how much I value education and how much sports. And because I really, really thought, and my parents did as well, that education is one of the most important things. United States is the place where to combine both of these in the best way possible. So I made the decision to go to the United States and then USC, and somehow have ended up here with playing beach volleyball for USC and simultaneously studying, of course.
Yeah, wonderful. So what do people back home think about your decision to go to the US for college?
Yes, it was hard to decide, but it was also hard to explain to people my decision, because there are a little bit of negative stereotypes about younger people leaving Latvia to go to study to the United States, because Latvia is a very small country, and we value every single person very highly. Therefore, there's some people who say, oh, these young kids, they go to foreign universities, they will stay there and never come back and be lost for our country. But I knew of this stereotype, and I somehow almost wanted to prove everyone that's wrong, and that's totally not going to be my case. And I actually think I've quite succeeded at it because I've shown that it's possible to combine both representing your country, Latvia, and still being a very big part of it, yet simultaneously most of the time of the year being away in Los Angeles.
Yeah, and I can't think of a better way to represent your country than competing in the Olympics.
And it's just also so nice because it's a way of bringing the word out into the world of Latvia, which, as I said, is small, so not everyone knows about it.
Mm-hmm. So at USC, how are you enjoying your political science courses? Because you're also a political science major.
Yes, political science. First of all, I'm so happy that I chose this course, this major, because it's so related to real life, and I really enjoy how in USC it's connected to the real life events. I've had so many classes where we're talking about things that are about to happen, especially this election year was, I would say, one of the most engaging to study political science. And it's something I really enjoy, so I'm doing good, thank you.
Awesome. So before we get to Olympic volleyball, what was this season like for you and your teammates competing for USC during the pandemic?
Yes, this was a special season, and it was so much harder than any other seasons, I would say, because we were expected to perform almost flawlessly, not only on the court, but our behavior outside of the court mattered even more than ever in terms of how we actually needed to 100% follow all the restrictions, follow all the guidelines. And that was quite hard. And therefore, I'm just so proud and actually really, really amazed of how wonderful teammates I had this season, to have everyone on the same page and everyone agreeing on holding each other accountable and in check. That was amazing that we all achieved the same thing together while being so disciplined about everything we do outside of the courts as well.
Yeah, that's amazing that you guys were able to, succeed in this really challenging situation, this really challenging season, and support each other as teammates. Were you able to spend as much time with your teammates as you normally would in a normal season?
I would say actually no, not as much. I definitely didn't spend that much time with my friends from the team as I would have otherwise. And it was quite difficult sometimes to figure out what was allowed and what wasn't. For example, can I do a pizza and movie party at my teammates' house, but with all my teammates? Because that's like more people than allowed. But at the same time, we practiced together. So there were a lot of blurred lines, which we figured out to just better not test out. So we just stayed safe, I would say, most of the time.
Mm-hmm. And I think another challenge must have been to play without fans. What was it like to play volleyball without, spectators, without an audience?
Yeah, this is probably, I think, one of the saddest and hardest things that I personally have had to deal with this summer with Corona, because for me, sport and beach volleyball essentially is a performance. It's showing what I have worked on and trying to give happiness to other people who are watching and enjoying what I do. And to not have these people on the court, I feel it very much, because it's not a one-way street where I just give to them. The spectators also give energy to us, and we just build off of each other, and it ends up being like this very awesome feeling when you compete with a lot of people watching. So I really hope, I can't wait for the summer to come, to have like spectators allowed.
Mm-hmm. So how did it feel after all of these hardships to win the national championship?
Well, it's not like we were struggling. We were treated so well this whole year, and I wouldn't call these hardships. It was just much higher level of discipline required. But it feels, I'm not gonna lie, really fantastic, because I came in as a freshman into this program, which had won, I think, already 4 championships. And my year was the first year when we didn't win it. And it felt so disappointing, because we tried so hard. And then this next year, it also didn't happen. And and to have finally, it feels like we didn't work for this championship only this semester. No, it feels like we have worked for this for these past two years. And it's very satisfying. It's a satisfying feeling. And I hope to enjoy it again next year, hopefully.
yes, hopefully. Yeah. So let's talk Olympics. So going to the beginning of your Olympics story, when did you start wanting to compete in the Olympics? What initially sparked your drive to become an Olympian?
Yes, the first Olympics that I remember consciously as a kid were the Beijing Olympics in 2008. And I think what struck me the most was the opening ceremony, just the grandness of it. It was amazing, unforgettable. And that's when I realized that that is such a prestige competition, which I would like to maybe participate one day. But what a moment when I really realized that I want to give it a real shot at trying to be a professional player and play at the Olympics was my freshman year at USC. And it sounds kind of like cliche, but really the environment USC surrounds us with, it's so forward driving. We're surrounded by so many amazing, it's such an amazing history of athletes that I think after I felt and saw all these amazing things and that people have done from USC, I kind of realized that I would maybe want to try that as well.
Yeah, and here you are adding to the history of Trojan athletes in the Olympics.
I hope so. I'm trying.
Yeah. So would you share what the Olympic trials were like? How did qualification go?
We were one of the first teams, me and my partner, Anastasia, we were one of the first teams to officially qualify for Tokyo, which was already like a year and a half ago, I think, 2019 fall. And it was a special qualification tournament in which we were by far not the favorites to win it. And I think that was our advantage because nobody was looking at us to get the ticket. And we just approached every match with the mentality of one match at a time, one point at a time. And by dividing this big task into these many small tasks, which we happened to successfully went together into the qualification for Tokyo. And that was the most amazing moment I've ever had in my life. I think I don't know if I'll ever feel like that again. It was just a pure just explosion of happiness, euphoria. I am a crier, so I started crying, and it's all recorded on TV, unfortunately. So I sometimes go and rewatch, and I still get goosebumps.
Wow, yeah. And after having qualified, what was the reception like when you came back home to Latvia?
Yeah, it was amazing. Because for beach volleyball, me and my partner, we are quite a young team. The prime age for beach volleyball is around 30 years old for women. So you need a lot of experience. That's what usually helps you. And us being only 22 and 23, that was kind of unprecedented almost. And also we are the first women's team from Latvia to qualify ever for beach volleyball. And that's another milestone that we reached. And I think that everyone who is following sports in Latvia at that time knew what we had done, and that's why it felt it was the reception was very nice, to say the least. We felt very loved for those weeks.
Is that something you appreciate about being from Latvia, that sort of everyone knows everyone and there is that strong sense of community?
Yeah, that's definitely a really big advantage of living in a small country, because if somebody achieves something big, everyone knows about it immediately, and everyone is happy about it, and you get put in the spotlight for the good or the bad. So you hope it's for the good. and that was the case for us. And yes.
All right. So before we go into a bit more discussion about the Olympics, we will have a Q&A section. So any viewers with questions, just go ahead and use the Q&A button to submit your questions. So in what ways have you learned the Olympics are going to be different this year from previous years? Will you be able to march in the Parade of Nations and see other athletes compete?
So many different sources of information have been going around. And in the beginning, I tried to follow everything, all the articles about what will change or might not, but it gets very tiring. So at this point, I've kind of given up a little bit on that, and I'm just trusting the officials of the Olympic Committee of Latvia to tell us the essential information that we need. And so far, what we've been told is that we will be allowed to be only at the place where we sleep, where we train, and where we eat. And we won't be allowed to go to other sports or support even our own other Latvian athletes. So I'm a little bit sad about it, because Olympics is more about, it's a lot about the experience, and because we play a lot of tournaments otherwise anyway. But about the opening ceremony, actually, maybe someone who's watching knows better than me, because we are expected to try on our parade outfits, and we are expected to bring them to Tokyo, but I can't imagine if that's actually happening. I'm not sure. Maybe someone has the information on this, but I don't know.
So not to get ahead of ourselves too much, but what would it mean for you to bring home an Olympic medal to Latvia?
Yes, let's not get ahead of us ourselves. That, but purely theoretically speaking, it would be that we would write our names into the history of Latvia for sure for a very long time. This sport, beach volleyball, has been gradually becoming more and more popular as the years go by, and at this point, it's very popular. And to get a medal, I mean, it's not only a personal dream come true for the whole country, because Latvia usually gets at most 3 medals in total in each Olympics. So that would be huge.
So what country do you expect to be your biggest competition?
Oh, well, yeah, it's an insult not to name every single country, because to qualify for the Olympics, that is so hard. And but the leaders for women are definitely Brazil, America, Canada. And it's funny how for the men it's completely the opposite. Europe is more the leading area in beach volleyball, but for women it's all the Americas.
Mm-hmm. So can you talk more about your playing partner? How did you, she's not a Trojan, right? How did you meet her? How do you play together?
Yes, she's not a Trojan. She's 1 year older than me. So she actually had to make the choice to go to the United States or not before me. And she decided not to go, even though she did also have offers. And that is one of the many things in which we're very different. And for just to like give an insight into how a beach volleyball team works, I would say that it's a very much like a business relationship almost. You're like job colleagues. You go to work every day, you have the same goal, you have the same expectations, you need each other very much. But me and Anastasia, we are also professionals in the sense that we meet up together and then we like go and do our own things. And I've known her since 2013, maybe, which is how many years ago? 9, I guess 8. So for a very long time, and you get to know someone very well by being together with them in all the highs, all the lows, and all the training camps where you're physically exhausted, mentally, and we're definitely bonded for life by going through this experience.
So it's not likely that many of our viewers have been to Latvia. So what are some of the things that you think really distinguish Latvia, or that you would like people most to know about your country?
Okay, this is so much pressure right now to advertise a whole country to so many people. I would say for me, what is close is the nature. And every time coming back from LA, I'm struck by how green it is here. And it's a European style of country. So the cities are very historical, old cobblestones, which I miss when I'm in LA, because the smooth pavement, concrete. That's kind of very boring in my opinion. But Latvia is also very, with a lot of very talented people. We're not a lot, but very talented. So it's anyone, if you have a chance, go. You won't regret it, most probably.
Yeah, that sounds lovely. I can sympathize with the lack of cobblestones in LA.
Yeah, true, but that's totally.
So we have a viewer question from Terry. Where do you play and practice in Latvia?
Yeah, very nice question. This gives me an opportunity to say one more thing that I just forgot in the previous question. I live in a seaside city. It's called Jūrma, and Latvia has a very long shoreline, which is all beach. And I think it's more than 600 kilometers of just beach, sand. And we have just our courts set up right next to my house here, and we go and train every day there for free because we are the national team, and that's another thing that's really cool about Latvia, that we have nice beaches that are very long.
Yeah, you sort of get the best of both LA and Europe with the long beaches and the nice historic cities and green space.
Yes, LA definitely is a beach volleyball hotspot for sure, and Latvia is maybe slightly behind, more than slightly, a little bit.
So with that final question, thank you so much, Tina, for talking with us and sharing your experience as a Trojan Olympian.
Yeah, thank you very much for having me. Enjoy talking. Hope I said something interesting at least. So thank you very much.
It's our pleasure. So now that we have heard about the modern Olympics, we will next take a journey backwards through time, thousands of years into the past, to travel to the world of the original ancient Greek Olympics with Professors Herchenroeder and Farenga. And again, please submit any questions you think of through that Q&A feature below, and we will get to them in the audience questions portion of the discussion. So, Dr. Herchenroeder, one of the most striking aspects of the ancient Olympics for us today is that the athletes competed naked. Where did doing sports naked in ancient Greece come from?
Hey Sean, thanks for having me. So the nudity of Greek Olympics is something we might be familiar with. Nudity has kind of two areas in which it is important in ancient culture. One is athletics and the other is heroism, for example, in the context of war, military achievement. You may be familiar, for example, with statues, heroic nudes, we might call them, of figures from mythology who are engaged for military exploits and things like that. And so I think it's important in starting off to recognize that nudity, and in particular, the male nude form, is associated in the Greek imagination with heroic achievement, exceptional feats, and things of that nature. And so from that perspective, broadly, it's easy to see how it's connected to exceptional achievement in the context of athletics, which also in the Greek imagination was very closely related to military activity and the kinds of training that young men would undergo before they sort of became full members of society. The Greek word for naked is gymnos, and in fact we get a verb from that, gymnastestai, which means essentially, literally it means to be naked, but it also means to exercise or to sort of conduct the physical training that we would think of as taking place in the gymnasium. And the gymnasium, our English word comes from the Greek word gymnasion, which is the place where one is naked, literally, but it also is a place of exercise. All of that being said, the Greeks had this idea that there was a historical story, I guess, as to why young men competed in athletic competitions at the Olympics included in the nude, and that's go back to the, I think, like the 14th or 15th Olympics at the end of the 8th century. A runner lost his loincloth, and the perceived advantage for aerodynamics was immediately recognized, and another runner, if I remember the anecdote correctly, replicated the nude race and also won. And from that point on, at least as the Greeks imagined in their past, foot races were conducted in the nude. And it was to such the extent that in the 5th century, we have the Athenian historian feels the need to explain, just even as you asked, to explain why is it that Greeks practice in the nude? And Thucydides tells us that the Spartans did it first, actually.
Hmm. So we get a couple different stories, but I'm really struck by that idea of the one guy who loses his loincloth and notices the aerodynamics, and then you know, other people catch on and it becomes a bug.
Yeah.
So you've mentioned to me before the idea of nakedness as a costume. It's not something so much that you reveal, but it's something that you take on as a costume. Could you tell us more about what nakedness meant in ancient Greece in that sense, in like the iconographic sense?
Yeah, good question. As much as nudity may seem to us like as a lack of signifying clothing, in antiquity it kind of had a positive charge to it, maybe is one way to think of it. And it was a woman I went to graduate school with who gave me this idea. Maybe it's current in other areas of scholarship on ancient Olympics, but yeah, she told me how in describing the friezes at the Parthenon, not in Athens but in Nashville, she would tell as a docent to those in attendance that heroic nudity, the nudity of young men in war-like situations, is kind of, it should be thought of as a costume. You know, it's the garb, or in this case, anti-garb, that one takes on when one is performing heroic feats, exceptional feats, whether in the context of battle or Olympics. And her line of thinking is that it should kind of be thought of as analogous to the cape of Superman, for example. It's something exceptional. It's marked and distinctive. And I think there are limitations to that analogy, but it's helpful for us as moderns to see the kind of positive charge, as I mentioned, of heroic or athletic nudity in antiquity.
Mm-hmm. So perhaps to risk stretching the analogy even further, okay, you know, comparing it to the modern Olympics, could we compare, you know, the nakedness of the athletes to a uniform a modern athlete wears that, you know, marks them out as like, this person is an athlete?
I think there's some merit to that. If Professor Farenga wants to add as well, please feel welcome. But certainly we're all familiar with the ways in which the bodies of athletes are on display by the costuming that is selected for them. And so I think the analogy is important also from the perspective that exceptional physical achievement also is connected to the visual, the visuals of the human body in the context of achievement. And in antiquity, these two things were kind of connected. You know, the exceptional appearance, exceptional beauty was thought to coordinate strongly or to correlate strongly with exceptional ability, whether moral or physical.
So that's interesting that there is this sort of moral connotation as well as it's obviously you're seeing muscles, it's a sign that someone is strong and physically, you know, talented. But there is also that moral connotation. Could you tell us more about that? Because that's something that's, I think, you know, pretty alien to us today.
Well, maybe I can jump in on that question, please. Sean. Maybe the nudity also signifies to the Greeks that a person is performing something extraordinary in a time and space which is not ordinary everyday time and space, but really religious time and space, a ritual space. Athletics had a very religious dimension for the Greeks. And just as they thought of their heroes from mythology and literature as interacting with the gods in a sacred time and in a sacred space of the heroic world, the heroic age, in a way, athletes were replicating that, were returning during the time of competition to that sacred time and space of the ancestors. And the nudity very much indicated that this was not ordinary activity in secular time and space.
That's really interesting that it is this sort of callback to the heroic past. You know, just through the nudity, and it calls on all these different things, you know, the athlete's physical ability and the religious idea and the sort of heroic model. So speaking of religion, that's another thing that a lot of people are surprised to learn about the ancient Olympics, is that religion actually played a massive role, as you know, today's games are completely secular. So Dr. Farenga, could you tell us what sort of, you know, rituals and religious experiences did attendees to the Olympic Games have?
Right, you could say that the Olympic festival, which ultimately developed into a 5-day festival, you could say that half the time was spent on athletics, competition, but half the time was spent on religious activities because the Olympics were supposed to be in honor of Zeus, the father of the gods, the chief god. The Olympics were also connected to the hero Heracles. Some people thought that Heracles was the first one to, on the particular spot where Olympia stood, he was the first one to make a sacrifice in that place to Zeus. And so he is sometimes thought of as the founder of the games. But the climax of the festival was really on the third day, when there would be in the morning of the third day, a procession of all of the athletes, all the competitors, all the judges, all the representatives from Greek states throughout the Greek-speaking world, which is basically the Mediterranean basin and the Black Sea area, all would take part in a procession to the sacred grove of Zeus, which was called the Altis, and they brought with them animals to be sacrificed, specifically 100 oxen or 100 bulls. And they came to a great altar sacred to Zeus that was quite a spectacular structure. It was about 22 feet high. It was about 125 feet in circumference, and it had several steps or layers. And the altar itself was made out of a kind of plaster that they concocted by mixing the ashes from the thigh bones of the sacrificed animals with the water from the sacred river, which flowed right by the site of Olympia, called the Alpheus. And so they made this plaster, and each year would add to the altar, and they would sacrifice the animals at the base, and they would butcher them and take the thigh bones up to the very top, and there they would burn them. And it was believed that the smoke and the aroma of this burning fat and meat was pleasing to the gods, especially pleasing to Zeus. So that would have been, for many of the attendees, the high point of the festival, much more so than any particular competition or victory that an athlete might win. Because when you went to Olympia, you were in effect going on a pilgrimage. Mm. You were going to a very sacred space. And unlike the modern Olympics, well, the modern Olympics can take place in any city really in the world, and it's certainly a legitimate games, whether it's in Beijing or Tokyo or Paris or soon in Los Angeles. But the Olympic Games could only take place in that one space, and only could take place at a specific time of year, which was late summer, either in August or September, which was, of course, the very hottest time of the year.
That's brutal.
In Greece. So it was said to be not the most comfortable experience if you were a visitor to the games. You basically had to camp out with thousands of other people in a very hot and dry and dusty place. But the Greeks thought that this was basically conferring on you a religious experience. They had a special word for the kind of seeing you did when you saw something extraordinary, saw something sacred. It was theoria, from which we get our word theory. And it's not ordinary vision. It's bearing witness to something sacred, something extraordinary happening. And in addition to the sacrifice at the great altar, I think for many participants, another highlight was to go into the temple of Zeus. The altar was outside in front of the temple. The temple, which was built in the 5th century BC, during the time, if people know, of the Golden Age of Athens, inside that temple, there was a colossal statue of Zeus made by the sculptor Phidias, who was to make a similar statue for the Parthenon in Athens. It was about a 40-foot high statue of wow. Zeus seated on a throne, holding out in one hand the figure of victory, Nike, whom the Greeks thought of as a winged female goddess. And the statue was a visual spectacle. It was made of ivory and gold. The skin was made of ivory, and the clothing that Zeus wore was made of gold. So that would have been, for many participants, again, the highlight of the games, is to look upon this amazing image of Zeus himself.
Yeah, I can see why that would, you know, induce theoria, that, you know, wonder seeing, just to see that you know, statue with the you know, lights glinting off of it. And the ash altar, I think that's interesting that it's built up over time. So you can actually see in the height of the altar itself how long they've been doing this. You can see the length of the tradition in the actual shape of the altar, which is pretty awesome.
Right, right. So, and yes, another interesting feature of that statue of Zeus is that the statue was surrounded by a reflecting pool, but the reflecting pool didn't have water in it. It had olive oil.
Huh.
One of the reasons being that the olive oil helped protect the ivory. I'm not sure of the chemistry of this, why water would not have done so, but the olive oil was thought to have a protective quality. So yeah, many oddities of that sort, at least to the modern viewer.
Yeah. So we just got a question from Nicholas. Were athletes competing for various regions or countries?
Yes, each athlete competed for his own state. The ancient Greek world was never unified politically. Even Greece itself was not a unified country. It was broken up into thousands of small states, city-states and federated states. And these states were very competitive with one another. They were constantly at war with one another and economically competing against one another as well. And so in a sense, the great games at Olympia and at some of the other great Panhellenic festivals are just another arena for competition. Mm. Another place where one state can demonstrate how outstanding its citizens are by sending boys and men to compete at Olympia, because there were events for boys as well as events for adult men. And when a victor won an event, this would be remembered forever back home in his own state. And he would be treated almost like one of the ancient heroes. He would be given privileges for life by his community. And those who could afford to would have a statue of themselves erected in the sacred grove of Zeus near the temple. So that space must have been crowded with thousands of male nude figures erected over centuries by some of the athletes who won their victories there.
Yeah, and we have a similar sort of space in Heritage Hall with all of our Heisman statues gathered together. So, you know, some things don't change.
Good idea. I think you could think of those statues as trophies of a sort, the sort of Heisman trophy of ancient Greece.
Mm-hmm. So turning to where these athletes trained to compete in the Olympics, they competed in a place called a gymnasion. So Dr. Herchenroeder, how similar was the gymnasion to a modern gym, and how was it different?
There's probably many things were similar, to the extent that it was a space for gathering together in groups to pursue different kinds of physical fitness. The Greeks also had a palaestra, which was a wrestling ground, which was where training was carried out for wrestling. The gymnasium also was an important hub of civic life, which is an intellectual life, which is important to keep in mind. And perhaps that aspect of the ancient gym kind of carries over, to the extent that, you know, we go to the gym not to just exercise and train, but also to gather with those with whom we regard ourselves as in some kind of community. And it's very clear that the gymnasium was regarded as central to civic life, central to the kind of social communities that the city was imagined as providing. For example, we know in a second century CE writer, Pausanias, who gives us a description of Greece, that the gymnasium is a defining feature of whether you have a city or not. You know, you have sort of nucleated settlements, you know, throughout the Greek world, but it's not a city for him, at least unless it has a gymnasium. In addition, you know, we have the 4th century BCE philosopher Plato tells us in his text, The Laws, he's sort of laying out the kind of a template for the ideal human community. And he links physical training at the gymnasium as essential to what constitutes a human community, at least one that's sort of poised for excellence. So the gymnasium, you can imagine all kinds of different kinds of civic activity and intellectual activity would be taking place alongside the physical training, which we associate automatically. And so maybe it's easy to kind of think of the gym as a place in which one is pursuing the life of physical excellence as well as the life of mind.
Yeah, I think one of the things that might surprise people is that, you know, Plato, this famous ancient Greek philosopher, is talking about the gym. So could you tell us more about Plato's connection with athletics?
Yeah, Plato may strike many of us as kind of airy philosopher, right? But Plato, many of his dialogues, he's writing in the 400s BCE, several of his dialogues take place nearby or, you know, on trips in between gymnasia, the plural of gymnasium, for example, the Lysis. And the topic of the dialogue, the Lysis, is friendship, right? And he thinks it fitting to set this dialogue adjacent or in the proximity of places of physical training, as if, you know, it makes perfect sense that one is pursuing physical excellence, but also thinking about pressing questions, as, for example, as to what is the nature of human friendship. And philosophy may strike us as a kind of distant, a remote or abstract activity, and maybe to an extent that's true. Platonic philosophy is interested in questions as to what is the nature of justice, what is the nature of beauty, but also kind of practical social questions: is what's the best form of society? What's the best way to organize ourselves so that we achieve the most out of life and out of ourselves and each other? And so the gym was an appropriate place to kind of carry out those kinds of questions. There's another interesting detail I should add: Plato, his name. There's a tradition, it's somewhat late, you know, how believable it is, I wouldn't be able to say, it would be beyond my expertise, but there's a tradition that it comes to us in a commentary on the Latin poem, the Aeneid, that his name, Plato, which is etymologically similar to the word for breadth, which is platos, refers to his breadth of shoulders. And this commentator on India gives us this story that before he devoted himself to philosophy, he had a successful life as a wrestler. And so we are to imagine that Plato, while we associate that so strong with philosophy, maybe the more immediate association is with wrestling.
Yeah, that's crazy to think that, you know, Plato's this sort of wrestling nickname that we've been using for this, you know. Thing.
Yeah.
If I could interrupt, you could say that the precinct at Olympia, where the games were held, was a gymnasium writ large. Hmm. I mean, just as local communities felt their fellowship, their comradeship at the gymnasium, what it was they had in common with fellow citizens. So all the Greeks from all the different regions of the Greek world came to Olympia to experience what it meant to be Greek and to share ideas. Because on the first day of the festival, in the afternoon, there were cultural activities such as philosophers giving talks and poets performing some of their works and historians also demonstrating their histories. And it's possible that they were also in competition with one another, or perhaps they were just displaying their knowledge, displaying their skills, so that there was this cultural element to Olympia. And also it had a political function, because many of the states, most of the states, would send an ambassador to participate. And you can bet that many political alliances were first explored and discussed and transacted at the Olympic Games. And or if you wanted to have an announcement made to the Greek world at large, you would have a herald, a messenger, make a public declaration at the Games And you would attract immediately the attention of the entire Greek-speaking world. So yeah, I think the games themselves are one gigantic gymnasium.
Yeah, that's really interesting that sort of what marks a city is having a gym, but then Olympia is like the gym for the entire Greek world. And it's sort of fulfilling those same functions of, you know, civic engagement and discussion and culture. So that's really interesting that you've got, you know, the Greek world's gym is Olympia. So here's a question from Colin. When and why did the original Olympic Games stop?
Stop. Yep. Oh, well, the Greeks said that they began in 776 BC or BCE, and they stopped over 1,000 years later in probably the 380s or 390s AD. 393 is sometimes given as the date, or 395. It was the world, of course, the Greek-speaking world had become rather Christian by that time. And the Byzantine Greek emperor Theodosius I was a Christian and a very militant Christian. And he wanted to stamp out pagan religious practices. So he forbid pagan religious ceremonies and sacrifices. And yeah, he put the kibosh on the Olympic Games after, I think over 1,100 years, more than a millennium.
Well, I guess that shows you how integral religion was to the Olympic Games, that, you know, they were pagan enough to be canceled by Christians.
Too threatening, yes.
So here's a question from Amy. Can you speak to the relationship between the Olympics and the Heraia and the participation of women in sports in the ancient games?
Well, yes, great question.
Go ahead. Go ahead, Lucas. Go ahead.
So as in every aspect of public life, women were essentially excluded and really, really heavily marginalized in ordinary circumstances. So it carries over pretty much the same for the Olympics. There was a festival at which women competed in the same stadium as men called the Heraia, as Amy, I believe our questioner's name is, mentions. This was women enjoyed a very, well, they were marginalized from many areas of social life. They enjoyed a very prominent role in certain aspects of cult life. And it's not known entirely what the, you know, all the details about the Heraia, but it does seem to have been an important site of cult activity connected to Olympia, veneration of the goddess Hera there at the site. And also it's told to us by one of the most important sources for that, Pausanias again, that the female priestess of Demeter presided over the, I believe, the normal races for the men. I don't know if, Vincent, you can correct me on that. But maybe the takeaway is that in the context of general exclusion, you had a sort of segregated space for female athletes at which they also competed, although some of the circumstances for that race, you know, very much set it apart from what were considered to be the main sort of stages of male heroic achievement in the context of the Olympic Games.
So how often were ancient Greek women allowed to be spectators at sporting events?
Well, at the Olympics, I think, yes, priestesses were permitted to attend. Also, unmarried women, that is, virgins, were permitted to attend. But married women were not. So they're definitely was reflected there, as in the rest of Greek society, this segregation of the sexes.
Why were particularly unmarried women allowed?
We don't know. You know, before there was an Olympic festival at that site, there was a worship of the mother goddess, and it was a fertility cult. And perhaps some of these rules and regulations were connected with that. So we don't know. We don't know what reasons would have been given for that exception.
Mm-hmm. So we can't confirm or deny whether the Olympics was a great place to pick up guys. So we have a question.
I think there's a footnote that we should add to that. While women were not permitted to participate in many of the activities, the chariot race, actually, the competitor was not the driver of the chariot, but the person who funded the team, including the driver. And we do know of one case in which a Spartan princess won the award for the chariot race in the early 4th century. So there you have it. I believe she's immortalized on an inscription in which she's described as the only woman of all of Greece to have achieved that distinction. Her case is exceptional. Maybe the exceptionality, maybe because it's so exceptional, it demonstrates just sort of how radically women were excluded from this male space.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's another interesting story about a woman who infiltrated the Olympics.
Oh, yeah.
Her name was Ferenike. She was from the island of Rhodes, and she was a trainer. And she trained her son in boxing, and he was really good. So, of course, she wanted to accompany him to the games. And she did, disguised, of course, dressed as a man. And he did win his event. And somehow, during the victory celebration, she became a bit careless, and it was seen that she was a woman. Ever after, we're told, competitors showed up at the games and their trainers accompanied them. Both had to present themselves naked to the judges. So, odd story.
Yeah, that's a really interesting story.
Yeah, yeah. We have some images of that four horse chariot race. I wonder if we could have a quick look at least how Greek artists depicted that event, which was the most prestigious of all the events.
So speaking of victory celebrations, for the ones that didn't go awry, how did athletes celebrate their victories?
Well, there were victory celebrations on the evening of the second day for the events that had taken place. The second day was the first day only boys competed in the morning. The second day you had the horse race, which was a huge event, and you had the pentathlon, which was five events: the discus, the javelin, the long jump, a running race, and wrestling. And then in the evening, you would have a religious ceremony, which was a repetition of the funerary ritual for the hero Pelops, who was thought to be buried there on the site. And that evening, you would have the first series of victory celebrations, victory songs, and dances, and feasting. And then on the fifth, the final day in the evening, all of the competitors would make a procession to the temple of Zeus, and there they would receive their reward for the games. They weren't competing for money. They were competing for prestige, and the reward was an olive crown, crown of olive leaves that came from one olive tree, a sacred olive tree behind the temple of Zeus that, it was said, Heracles had planted. And then the athletes would be showered, not with confetti, as might happen today when you win a championship, but with leaves, a shower of leaves over all the athletes. And also, people would tie wool ribbons to the athletes' bodies, to their arms or to their legs. The wool ribbons were another sign of this is an extraordinary person. There's something sacred about this person. And of course, that night was a night for feasting as well.
So I'm really, speaking of similarities to modernity, I'm struck by the victory song. And while it's not quite the same thing, we do have, you know, very extravagant Super Bowl halftime shows. So we still have, you know, music integrated with athletics today. So
absolutely.
We have a question from, yeah, there's the image. We have a question from Ed. How often were the first Olympics held?
Every 4 years.
So just like today?
Yes. Yes. When the modern Olympics were created in the late 19th century, it was certainly decided that they would be held with the same schedule. There was another feature, though, of the ancient Olympics, which I wish we had when our modern Olympics are performed. A truce was declared among all the different Greek states, whom, as I said, were often hostile and at war with one another. There was a month-long truce. And then as the games attracted athletes from more distant places in the Greek world, the truce was extended to 2 months and ultimately became a three-month truce. So it actually had, in addition to religious and political, cultural and athletic significance, it actually had a significance on warfare.
Yeah, I think the modern Olympics, I think part of the founding mission was world peace, but I agree we should bring back this, the worldwide truce. That'd be pretty sweet.
Yep.
So we've got a question from Alan. He says, isn't there a vase that shows an athlete appearing to do a long jump and he's holding something like weights in his hands? What's going on there?
Right. That's the long jump was an important event. It was part of the pentathlon. The athlete didn't take a running start and then leap from a line as the modern long jumper does. The athlete was in a standing position and he had two weights, one in each hand, and he would extend the weights out when he launched his body and they gave more momentum. Again, I think we might have a slide. We might have a picture of that event. Yeah. So obviously they weren't jumping as far as a modern long jumper would, but jumping using, I think, a different set of skills if you're holding weights in your hand and trying to launch your body as far as you can go.
Mm-hmm. So we have a question from Thomas. It came up earlier that there was the day for boys as competitors. So what was the average age of original Olympians? Do we know?
Good question. I am not certain. The boys were clearly in early adolescence, and the athletes who competed would have been considered mature men. And I think it would be their citizenship status which would determine whether they competed as men or as boys, because in each Greek state, you became a fully fledged citizen at a certain age, 21 or 18, and that meant that you were now ready to participate fully in public life. So I think the boys were in their early teens.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we are brushing up against the time, but we are getting so many questions that if you guys are willing, I think we will go on for just a little longer to satisfy everyone's curiosity about the ancient Olympics. So here's a question from David. What were the food and drink aspects of the Olympic ceremonies? What were the types of foods eaten at these feasts, like the victory feasts?
Right. When the Greeks ate meat, they sacrificed the animal to the gods, and they would butcher the animal right on the spot where it was slaughtered on the altar, and then they would cook that meat by boiling it, not roasting it, but boiling it. And so that great feast on the third day from the great hecatomb would have taken place in the evening. So the animals they slaughtered, in addition to cattle, such as oxen or bulls, would be sheep and goats, I think predominantly. Other festivals, pigs might have been the animals that were sacrificed.
Mm-hmm.
So, and the drinking was obviously water and wine, usually mixed.
Mm. Unlike those barbarous Macedonians up north.
Right, who didn't mix their wine.
So With that last question, we have reached the end of the Dornsife Dialogue. Thank you so much, Professors Herchenroeder and Farenga, for joining us and sharing your ancient Greek expertise. And thanks as well to our technical support behind the scenes. We could not do it without you. And of course, thank you all very much for watching and learning from our wonderful guests about the world of the Olympics, both old and new. Have a good weekend, everyone.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to subscribe to our podcast and visit us at podcasts.usc.edu.